Good evening, everyone. My name is Vicki Goodman, and on behalf of the Friends of the Semmel Institute, it's my pleasure to welcome you to this evening's Open Mind program. Thank you all for braving what was one of the worst nights of traffic in West Los Angeles to get here this evening. You are really troopers, and we are very grateful. And we are very excited to have with us this evening Dr. Maryanne Wolf, who is a scholar, an author, a teacher, and an advocate for children and literacy around the world. And we are so fortunate that Dr. Wolf is a visiting professor here at UCLA, which is the reason we were able to have her come here this evening. She is the director of the newly created Center for Dyslexia, Diverse Learners, and Social Justice at the UCLA Graduate School of Education and Information Studies. Previously, she was a professor of citizenship and public service and director of the Center for Reading and Language Research in the Elliott Pearson Department of Child Study and Human Development at Tufts University. Dr. Wolf is the author of four books, the critically acclaimed Proust and the Squid. I had to look up today to make sure I pronounced Proust correctly. The Story and Silence of the Reading Brain, Dyslexia, Fluency, and the Brain, Tales of Literacy for the 21st Century, and the book that you are here to learn more about this evening, Reader Come Home, The Reading Brain in a Digital World. We are really excited to have Dr. Wolf with us this evening. You will have a chance to purchase her book after the presentation, and she will also take questions from the floor following her presentation. For those of you who are here for the first time, the Friends of the Semmel Institute is a support group for the world-renowned Semmel Institute for Neuroscience and Human Behavior. It is one of the most preeminent centers for the study of the mind, brain, and behavior in the world. And we put on these programs, the Open Mind, as a public service to the community. And we hope that you find them informative. And if you do, we hope that you will remember us, especially at this time of giving in your year-end gifts. We depend on the support of our members to continue to bring these programs free to the public. So we'd be very grateful for your help so that we can continue to do so. Now, without any further ado, please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Maryanne Wolf.
Thank you so much. Well, I come from Boston, and those of you who were here before, you know I tested the audio system by a poem from Emily Dickinson about the brain, and I will actually begin with the last stanza. The brain is just the weight of God, for heft them pound for pound, and they will differ if they do, like syllable from sound. Well, I must say, coming from Boston, I always have to have some New England piece with me, but to come and be here the last 2 months has been an extraordinary experience. And I have to say, other than your freeways, which I hate, and which we all share, and the terrible, terrible destruction, I can't begin without thinking of all the people who are affected in California. Aside from those two very awful parts, I love LA. My friends in Boston can't believe it. They don't want to hear it. So no, come back. But at any rate, I'm so pleased to be here. I want to begin by saying that I am here for at least a year or two to develop this center. And at the heart of all that we're doing here, and in various parts of the world, the social justice is part of my work in global literacy in Africa and India and Australia and our own backyards. But at the heart is the belief and the commitment to the idea that literacy is a basic human right, a across every learner, across every age, background, country, etc. But you're going to hear a different part of that story. It's not only a basic human right, it is a vehicle for our best thought. And so I want to take you through a kind of set of goals that I have here at UCLA, and then I'm going to move into the book's letters. And yet, at the bottom of everything, all of my work, whether it's on literacy and neuroscience, or whether it's on children in LA Unify, where I'm also working, the idea is, please, anybody who comes, we know the traffic, just come in and don't worry about it, is the concept that our work on understanding the reading brain and the reading brain of children with dyslexia will help all of us teach children to read around the world. So one of the things that we're doing is confronting in LA the paradox that is across the world, but especially in our own backyards here in LA, and that is that identification often doesn't happen till grade 2 or grade 3, sometimes it doesn't even happen at all, and yet we know early intervention is what is best. And so some of my research will be on bringing our new understanding from cognitive neuroscience about how we can predict in kindergarten various types of struggling readers and what to do about it. So even though this talk tonight is not about that, I want you to realize that my work here is about the connections between cognitive neuroscience and what goes on in the brains of our children who are learning to read in various circumstances. And so without much more ado, I want you to realize that I am bent set in LA in connecting neuroscience and education. But my work has also led me to an unexpected, if you will, epiphany at the end of the book, Proust and the Squid, The Story and Science of the Reading Brain. I had worked 7 years. Some of you know what it is to write papers and books. It took me 7 years. Partly because I was trying to be a good mother at the same time and a good teacher and a good grant raiser, and you know what the story is. So it took 7 years. At the end of 2007, however, I looked up and this apologia for reading was changing underneath my fingertips. I had to rewrite the very end of the book and the beginning to confront the fact that reading itself had changed while I had my head buried in the research. And one of the people who unexpectedly helped me think about this was the wonderful Italian writer Italo Calvino. And he said this in an age when fantastically speedy widespread media are triumphing and running the risk of flattening all communications onto a single homogeneous surface. We need a rhythm of time that passes with no other aim than to let feelings and thoughts settle down, mature, and shed all impatience or ephemeral contingency. I began to struggle with this because it was very clear in front of me, under my fingertips, with my students, that a form of cognitive impatience was taking over the ways we were, in fact, reading. And so I began to consider that I had to do, in my work, use my understanding of the reading brain and the reading brain circuit to confront these issues about how we read and therefore how we think and how we act in a digital world. And so I began to think about how would I best do this? And I did two things. I wrote a book almost none of you will ever read. It was for Oxford Press, and it's one of those academic books that no one reads. So that's the Tales of Literacy. But that gave me the idea. I need to bring this research and make it accessible even to the opera members over here on the left. I can't believe there's people looking like an opera here. But the reality is I began to think of what would make this work accessible. And I have, before I went into the area of study that I'm in, I had 2 degrees in English literature and was very influenced by Rainer Maria Rilke. How many of you ever read Letters to a Young Poet? Ah, yes, you're mine, or I'm yours, and he's ours. And so I began to think that the letter gives us a perfect opportunity to have a dialogue between author and reader. But there was something else that those of you who have read the book, it warrants rereading now, that you are a more mature reader. And for some of you who are writers, it is an example par excellence of an author writing to someone he will never meet. And yet there's a tenderness, a true attempt to pass over, a theological term, to pass over into the reader's perspective. And I thought, what better goal could I ever have than to try to do that? And so I began to write letters about the various themes that had come into my work and our world. And our world is in, this is a term that Robert Darnton, the historian of reading at Harvard Library, always talks about, the hinge moment. Well, we are in that. And we've had these huge transitions in communication. But this one is perhaps as, or at least on par with the great momentous upheavals that our other transitions made. And I had to confront that I work in an area where I know how literacy changes our brain. If we study those human beings who, through no fault of their own, were in one family and one is literate and one is non-literate, and we study their brains, we are well aware of the differences in those connections in the brain of a literate person. Literacy changes the brain, which changes the entire trajectory of an individual's life, which changes society, which changes the future of our species. This hinge moment, how we read, not just what we read, but how we read, will have implications for the species because it has all begun to change. Now, I want, as a kind of preamble to discussing the book, something that my colleague from MIT, Shiri Turkle, has written in the book Alone Together. We transgress, not because we try to build the new, but because we do not allow ourselves to consider what it disrupts or diminishes. Now, I need you to do a F. Scott Fitzgerald act with me. Those of you who remember what he said about the first-rate mind, that the first-rate mind can handle 2 contradictory positions and not go crazy, well, that's what we're going to do tonight. We're going to look at contradicting aspects of 2 mediums. But there are no binaries. If you think of this as the old and the new, you are missing the entire point of what I want to bring across. And that is, it's not about print versus digital. It's about figuring out what are the processes, the cognitive, linguistic, and affective processes that are propelled by different mediums. And so my talk is not the talk you might have thought it was. You might have even seen my bag coming in that says, I cannot live without books, Thomas Jefferson. That will be true. At the same time, we are all involved in a digital world, and we have to figure out what I consider cognitive choice. What is the purpose of what we are reading? And how can we literally figure out this moment in time by fusing science, the science of the reading brain, with technology to figure out how do we choose who we will become as readers? So this first tackle of the issues led me to begin the book after an introduction of asking, who will we become? What are our cognitive choices? The choices begin literally under this, I said the big top, but you those of you who read will figure out why I make the brain like a circus. But I want people to realize what a circuit is, how the human brain, and this was the first sentence in Proust and the Squid, the human brain was never born to read. This is something that people don't realize. They think it just comes naturally. There are even reading programs that hate me because they're called Read Naturally, and I yell and scream. There is nothing natural about the reading brain. It is built up. It is acquired. It is developed. But it can do this because we have this almost semi-miraculous capacity in the human brain to rearrange its parts and to connect parts that are genetically programmed. So the reading brain circuit is plastic. It is formed from these older cognitive and linguistic structures, and we recycle parts of our brain to take on the aspects of reading. So the first principle is that we form this circuit by connecting other networks. We're forming this thing. But to do so, we literally recycle neurons. So just as a tiniest example, the neurons that you have for, I have only one face I know in the audience. Only one face. I have a set of neurons for his face. Now, it's probably not in my left hemisphere. It could be, it used to be, before I learned to read, it would have been. But in this area here, we have neurons that are for facial recognition, for object recognition. We recycle those, and the face recognition actually sometimes goes over to the right hemisphere. But those neurons that were originally for recognizing your faces and objects are now being used to make automatic representations of letters and letter patterns. This is just a tiny example. Don't you worry about, you are not late. The freeways are terrible. That's what we all know. You sit and be comfortable. I'm going to say that as many times as it takes to make everybody happy. But now the third, so you are all walking in as I talk about, the only thing you have to know while you sit is the brain makes a circuit that's plastic to read, okay? You guys who just sat down, just capture that thought. It's plastic. It doesn't belong there. It's made, okay? Now, it is a circuit that is not only plastic, there's no one ideal form. It is rather a reflection of writing systems. I just love the Chinese and the Japanese kanji writing systems. Look at how much right visual cortex is there. Why do you think? Just yell out, why? Why would you need? That is so cute. That's a first. That's a first. Oh, I love it. I love it. Well, thank you. Why do you think there's more right visual cortex necessary for the Chinese writing system and the kanji Japanese system? Why do you think?
It's more visually complicated.
Oh, that's true. What else? Brain is plastic. That's great. What else?
They read from right to left.
Well, that it's more not. Never mind. What I want you to say is, how many characters do you think it takes for the brain of a Chinese reader to be fluent by fifth grade? How many think they know?
Several thousand.
So, what did you say?
Several thousand.
Absolutely. About 5,000. Now, I always say this to people. You are the most complaining people with 26 measly letters. I always say this, and then people, that's right. There's a lot of other things we do that the Chinese and the Japanese kanji reader does not that require different things. But I just use this as an example to show the brain reflects what's asked of it. What's asked of it in a writing system and what is asked of it in a medium. And that will be the continuing story today. Because what we do with this circuit, as children, they are learning to decode information, and they're using all of these basic processes. Then, when they learn to decode, they have to decode fast enough to make what I consider a Proustian leap, if you will, from the decoding of information to the connection to what I call the deep reading processes. These are the really sophisticated ones, and we will go through that in just a minute. But it's essential for you just through this to realize there's no one circuit. It can be very basic, or it can be elaborated. And everyone here has probably some of the most beautiful elaborated networks because it is all part of what happens with that brain. But my big question, since the time it takes to connect those processes is in fact intensive, I am worried that in a digital age where the medium is extremely powerful in hastening us on, and there are many aspects that are good, the speed with which the screen is reflected in the medium will take away from the time that we are allocating to the deep reading processes. And I want to look at them just relatively quickly with you. Proust said something that I used as in a certain way as the leitmotif of my first book for the public. And that is that he believed that at the heart of reading, what we are doing is going beyond the wisdom of the author to discover our own best thoughts. That is an incredibly powerful and, I believe, epiphanous statement about what reading is. But it doesn't come for free. It comes because we have gone through a set of cognitive processes and affective processes that bring together some of the most sophisticated things about our minds. The first is that after we have decoded this information, we connect it to what we know, what we call background knowledge. Now, I'm worried about background knowledge because it requires attention to consolidate what we're reading in memory. That will come back to haunt us. But we are analogy makers. We draw an analogy from the new to our old. We're always matching it. And then we use that to, oh, there's an error here. It should be inference, not interference. That is interfering with my inferential skills. However, the reality is we have these scientific method-like processes where we're inferring from this information, this analogy we're drawing. We're making deductions. I liken it to the Sherlock Holmes kind of aspect of our brain. That's not the only thing we're doing. We are using imagery. We're using voice. We are using, and this is something that people do not understand as much as we need to, both in terms of children and ourselves, but an aspect of deep reading is not only thinking, the thinking stuff, but the affective dimension of reading, the empathy, the going beyond. I want to pause here. How many of you heard Alberto Manguel? I know one of my new friends there. Alberto Manguel is one of the finest authors, and he was here. I'm so sorry you didn't hear him. But he said something that I at least want to just say, just to in honor of his work. Reading is cumulative and proceeds with geometric progression. Each new reading builds upon what the reader has read before. This is you. These are your networks, what you read. Some of you are voracious readers. It's all building elaborated networks. So literally that background knowledge is the stuff of what you're making analogies with every time you come to something new. But I had begun to tell you about an affective dimension. This is the aspect of empathy that reading allows us. I use the theological term passing over. When we read, we move outside ourselves. The child learns through every single frog and toad and George and Martha story about how other people feel. And from a cognitive neuroscience viewpoint, we know that what is happening in the brain, the activated areas, are not just the feeling centers, but those regions that are responsible for theory of mind. When you pass over and you think, when you encounter someone else, someone you don't know, an historical epoch, a perspective that's new to you and different, it requires a lot of cognitive and affective areas to process, and the brain of the activation patterns and brain imaging show that. I use this beautiful interview in the back of the book, The Givenness of Things by Marilynne Robinson, to illustrate what Obama said. Obama, those of you who know this, asked her for an interview, went to her and said, it is the novel that taught me so much about moral and ethical development, that it is not black and white, but gray. And novels make me bury myself in the stuff of what leads to empathy. To which she said, the trend towards seeing those different as sinister other is the greatest danger to continuing our democracy. Little did I know, little do any of us know, that the way we read adds to the moral laboratory of empathy, whether we are 4 years old and listening to stories, whether we are 14 years old and encountering others who are completely outside our kin, or whether it is us who are becoming ever more involved in familiar silos and not necessarily going outside our comfort zones. I don't believe that's true of almost anyone in this room, but it's a trend that is for all of us. Now, I said there's Sherlock Holmes. Well, Sherlock Holmes really isn't a good analogy for our brain. It's Miss Marple. And those, I was in Canada and I've been in Norway, and not everyone knows Miss Marple, but I hope you do. Because what Miss Marple does, that the deep reading brain does, it puts it all together. It puts the scientific method processes with our affective, intuitive, transporting processes. Now, I also just came back from Italy, where I had to use St. Thomas Aquinas for this, because G.K. Chesterton's biography, if you haven't read a biography that will make you laugh, just read G.K. Chesterton. This is the biography of Thomas Aquinas, but there was a serious part that is the reason why I give him the deep reading brain. He said, when asked what he's most grateful for in life, I am most grateful that I understood every page I ever read. What a goal. What a wonderful, wonderful thing to be able to say. But I put it in front of the deep reading brain to show you how beautifully elaborated it all is. But it takes milliseconds of our time as an adult, and it takes years to form as children. It is never a given, and it can atrophy. And that is a piece of what this next letter is about. Who are we going to become? I use Patricia Greenfield from UCLA to say, far better than I ever wrote exactly what my worries are based upon. Every medium has its costs and weaknesses. Every medium develops some cognitive skills at the expense of others. The internet may develop impressive visual intelligence and much more than that. But the cost seems to be deep processing, mindful knowledge, inductive analysis, critical thinking, imagination, reflection. This is deep reading. This is what the worry that I have began with. That's how I began, with looking at the reading brain, knowing it reflects differences of the medium, and then beginning to ask the questions. My colleague Naomi Barron from American University, a linguist there, asked, the real question is whether the affordances, the characteristics of reading on screen lead us to a new normal, one in which length and complexity and memory, and especially concentration, are proving more distracting, or proving more challenging. It's distracting is also equally true. The reality from the evidence that I'm going to give you only the top of the iceberg, but I'm going to give it to you quickly, and I need you to realize there's a lot of good research now in about five different areas. One of them is eye movement, and Ziming Liu is from San Jose State, and Mangan from Norway, Jacobs from Berlin, all finding that when most of us are reading, we're following an F, sample in the middle and come down, or a Z. We sample the beginning, we word spot our way down to the bottom, and then we finish it off. Some of you might have questions, because it's really important to understand that this eye movement research is just looking at what we're doing on pages that we, who are readers, you, who anyone who comes to this, is a true, what I would call a true good reader. The reality is, even we are doing such a skimming job because so much of our day, 6 to 10 hours, is on a screen that bleeds over its characteristics even when we're not on that screen. We have less time that we are using for long form. We are, especially our young adults, are distracted about 27 times an hour. The effect is upon the sustained attention span. The quality of attention that we have is required for us to consolidate what we're thinking and reading in memory. When we are skimming, we are actually doing a whole lot of different things that are a product of the fact that we're not reading less. We're reading 50 to 100,000 words a day. The glut that we have affects this, how much we read is affecting how we read. So skimming is a defense mechanism on the one hand, but it's also having important implications. If you are skimming a poem, if you are skimming a very dense, complex, either a contract or a novel or a piece of science, an article, by and large, when you skim, you are missing not just facts and your ability to check them, but you are missing the beauty of the argument or the beauty of language itself. So there's going to be cognitive, literary, and affective implications for what is going on when we skim. Because another aspect of these two is that it begins to narrow. Paradoxically, when we have so much, we're actually going to the more familiar silos. Not saying that you in this audience are, but so many of our fellow citizens are faced with this glut, faced with this skim, and faced with a kind of malaise, cognitive malaise, an impatience that's taken over. We end up, many, many humans, going into silos of comfortable information that supports what we thought before we even began. This literally takes away from the purposes of being able to read alternative perspectives, it also makes us more susceptible to false information. If what we read and believe it's comfortable and we don't have a cognitive allocation of critical analysis, if we aren't doing that with these comfortable aspects of what we're reading, we are vulnerable. We are vulnerable to things that are being said that are false, whether they are just false facts or false fears or false hopes that we know are not true, but we have not allocated enough time to check and monitor how we think. This, in turn, is influencing imperceptibly in our society what is written. What is written can be very influenced by how we read. Many, many people are being asked to write less dense, shorter, briefer text. And so we have even our novelist coming under the scrutiny of editors who think it could be shorter. You know, the span is not the same. This, in turn, this whole thing will influence the very basis of why you are all here and why I am here. We are people who believe that our best thought is what maintains us as individuals and as a society. And why we read, even though I didn't take you to the very end of the deep reading processes, I will in just a second or two, it is how we think and reflect upon what we read, how we are transported, how we are immersed. Reading is one of the most powerful sanctuaries, holding grounds for our best thoughts. And if we, because of all this, are losing why we read, and many of you, without even admitting it to yourself, are no longer as immersed, no longer as able to be transported by how you are reading. This worries me incredibly. There are implications for the reader and for our society. If reading changes to adapt so completely to digital characteristics, we will reduce deep reading with less time that is necessary to grasp the complexity of arguments. We will have less time allocated to understanding who others are and their feelings. We will have less time for the apperception of beauty. I'm not sure if I have this next slide from Italo Calvino. I didn't. But he said that the act of writing is this incredible process in which we are trying our very hardest to wed our best thought with words. Well, if you're doing an F or a Z, you're missing the very process, the very beauty of much of the language that's been expended by our best writers. The implications for society are even more dire. I believe that if we begin as a society to read in such ways that we are reducing the time for critical analysis and empathy, there will be a less attention given to alternative viewpoints from our own, more susceptibility to false information, demagoguery, and divisive thinking that threatens a democratic society. Life isn't black and white. It's gray. It's full of every variation of gray. I hesitate to have the association of 50 shades of gray. It just came to my mind. You need a little lightness. But the reality is that we who read critically and with empathy and confront viewpoints that are not our own are necessary for the very heart of a society whose very fabric is based on having many voices being heard. Now, all of this I bring back to, in my letters 5-8, to our children. Because even though I am worried about you, I have to admit You're second in my worries. My biggest worries are the formation of the deep reading processes that are the basis, the foundation for the thinking of our children. And so I've been working with pediatricians like Barry Zuckerman and Jenny Radesky and others, and worrying through what would the guidelines be. Now, those of you who have long flights to Europe or New York or Australia, this is the only time when I want to see an iPad with the kids. Because the reality is, it's become a pacifier. It's become a babysitter. And it's become what is a hoped-for vehicle for sometimes teaching language better. The reality is that language development is better with humans than with the bells and whistles of all these digital devices. And Catherine Hirsch-Pasek and Barry and others are working on the evidence for this. And the evidence comes in various ways. There's studies of language development, but there's also brain activation studies by pediatric neurologist John Hutton at Cincinnati, in which he's simply first looking at what happens when babies and young kids are given books to read at every well visit. Now, this is a wonderful place to talk about this. How many of you know about Reach Out and Read, the pediatricians group? Everybody should know about it. So the fact that you have it, find out who your pediatricians are and whether they're part of it. Because they simply are dedicated to the development of literacy and the literacy precursors in the 0 to 5 group. They just simply give books in well visits. And then they look at the kids who get these books and are read to regularly and compare them. And what you see is not a surprise. Every grandmother who is a pediatrician especially, could have said that what is happening is that the receptive knowledge of language is developing more with the kids who are read to. One of the most fun things I do, and I can't do it for you because it would take an extra hour, is just to tell you what children's books do from 0 to 5, and 5 to 10, and even 10 to 15. These are things that come, if you will, for free that we should be doing, because they not only develop the receptive, they're also developing the expressive aspects of language. But John Hutton did something that is much more interesting in terms of tonight's topic. He looked at what is happening with brain activation patterns of language regions when you look at parent versus an audio version of the same book versus an animated screen version. What do you think? What do you think? I'm leading you here. The parents are best. Humans, the grandparents are best. The kids are best. The reality is that young children do extremely well with us giving an interactive language experience, and that all the bells and whistles are actually third in line. It's too much distraction. And yet my colleagues like Catherine Steiner Adair, who are working from clinical viewpoints, are very much concerned with what is happening to even our youngest children in terms of what you might call, and has been called this for a while, the continuous partial attention of our children that leads them to always need stimulation. And what's the first thing they say when they go offline? I'm bored. There is a new kind of boredom, I think, that we are confronting as a society. It's not the boredom that I think all of us had, and when we had it, we did something. We were creative. We went outside. God forbid they go outside. But this is really something that is not at all like what the philosopher Walter Benjamin said about boredom or ennui as it was giving birth to creativity. He called it the hatchbird of invention, the hatchbird of creativity. That's not the kind of boredom we're seeing. We're seeing a difference in their hormonal levels too young. And people like Catherine Steiner Adair in her book, The Big Disconnect, are really looking at that carefully. But what do the changes in attention mean? They aren't just in the beginning of the process of the reading circuit. They are affecting how attention is given and then consolidated in memory and then used for the rest of the comprehension processes. So changes in attention are not single aspects of what we're seeing. We're seeing that it is having an effect on the comprehension of text and the sequencing of details. Now you think about the screen and the details. All screens have this evanescent aspect that hasten us along. That's our set. We have a psychological set towards a screen. Well, what my colleagues in Europe in the, something called the eRead Network are doing, especially Anne Mangan from Norway and Adrian van der Veel, they are looking at just what our young people are doing when they read the same text in digital screens versus print. And they want to know what are the ways they are comprehending in those same content, but two mediums. And what they're finding is that there are changes in the comprehension of the material when it's on a digital medium. They are less able to get the gist. They are less able to get the sequence of the plot. Now, my colleagues in Israel, Tommy Katsir, Marit Barzilai, and others, are looking at this with even younger children, fourth and fifth graders. And they're finding this same effect, even including changes in empathy with our children. Now, Sarah Conrath and Sherry Turkle have been looking at these changes in empathy. And I believe this is an area we must have far more research on. These studies that are involved, I think, need to be completely updated. This first study by Conrath was in 2011. We need to know what is happening, especially now. But Sherry Turkle is completely convinced that what we're seeing is that the paradoxical effect of being super connected, one hopes and thinks, is not a reality in the everyday lives of our children. And so there is a false hope, a false promise when this concept of connectedness is examined closely. And we need far more research on it. What we don't need is, and this is absolutely an amazing study, we don't need a meta-analysis. We have never had one, and now we do. A meta-analysis takes all the studies that have looked at the print versus digital screen mediums with the same content. So we now have, and this is just this, I just came back last month, and this study is by a group. Delgado is the student, Salmeron from Spain, and they looked at 171,000 subjects. We don't need to do that study again. But the reality is that they found is that the majority of the studies show that print is superior in comprehension effects over digital. Now, here's the real surprise for me. They looked at the studies from 2000 to 2017. And the question that I ask you is, what do you think our young people who are recent digital natives, like closer to 2017, what do you think they're better at, digital versus print? So the kids who are closer to 2017, what's your answer? Print. The opposite of what you might think. They are believing, and then the next set of studies is from Rakefet Ackerman and her colleagues in Israel. They ask the students, well, what do you perceive you're better at? And of course, they perceive they're better at digital because they're faster. Fast. And David Ulan said this beautifully. He's your LA reporter who wrote a great book, The Lost Art of Reading. But anyway, he said this idea that speed is a source of illumination is an illusion. It's not the case that speed equals better comprehension. And so our students are, they have no idea, it's imperceptible. But the effect is something I and you, we all have to take with great seriousness, because the reality is that they are reading less print daily than ever before. 70s and 80s, 60% would pick up something every day. It's 16% more or less right now. And so the economy of attention by our young is changing. The questions that I have to address publicly, will these changes in attention and the immediacy of external platforms of knowledge threaten the formation of background knowledge in the young? If background knowledge and attention are threatened, will inference and critical analysis decline, leaving young readers susceptible to false information and less able to handle sophisticated text? My response is we need to understand both mediums, and there will be other mediums. We need to understand it so that technology and science can help us preserve deep reading as we are expanding the absolutely essential aspects of coding and programming and all these wonderful aspects of visual intelligence. So I have about 5 minutes left with you, and I'm going to use them for you more than for the kids at this moment. But I want you to know that part of my book is a proposal for a biliterate brain in which I'm asking people to consider bringing print to bear from 0 to 10 on the formation of deep reading, and simultaneously using our digital media to do all the wonderful things of expanding their skills that are absolutely necessary for things like STEAM, programming, coding, etc. And then wherever their deep reading is formed with print, explicitly teaching them, not the way you and I did willy-nilly, but really understanding how to ask, what is the purpose? And for this kind of purpose for my reading, I need to use this mode, so that ultimately we are talking about deep reading across mediums. And now I'm going to use my last 5 minutes for you. You're the good readers, but there's a story here that we really need to examine among ourselves. Aristotle said that a culture can be judged by how it pursues three lives: the life of activity and productivity, the life of enjoyment, and the life of contemplation. I believe that the good reader is just like the good society. Among the three lives, this is theologian John Donne, we have a life of action and a life of enjoyment, but for the most part, we are lacking a life of contemplation. There are dire consequences of this. I think the same for reading. I think the very heart of reading, when we use Proust as talking about going beyond the wisdom of the author to ourselves, we are in the process of atrophying, unbeknownst to ourselves, what is going on in that sanctuary, what Philip Davis calls the holding ground. And I use this quote from David Ulin to bring to life the third life. I have never met him. I've always wanted to tell him thank you. This is my thank you to him by quoting him here. To read, we need a certain kind of silence that seems increasingly elusive in our over-network society. And is it not contemplation we desire, but an odd sort of distraction, masquerading as being in the know? In such a landscape, knowledge can't help but fall prey to illusion, just like the students, that speed can lead us to illumination, that it is more important to react than to think deeply. Reading is an act of contemplation, an act of resistance in a landscape of distraction. It returns us to a reckoning with time. Time is what I study. Time is what I desire for the reading brain circuitry. It requires time if we are to always be questing for discernment, discernment of truth, our own wisdom. Each of these deep reading processes depends on the allocation of time we give. Use it or lose it in our hinge moment should be transformed to choose it. And here I will end with Martha Nussbaum. It would be catastrophic to become a nation of technically competent people who have lost the ability to think critically, to examine themselves, and to respect the humanity and diversity of others. And unless we support these endeavors, it is in such a nation that we may well live. It is therefore urgent now to support curricular efforts aimed at producing citizens who can take charge of their own reasoning, who can see the different and foreign not as a threat to be resisted, but as an invitation to expand their own minds and capacity for friendship. The future of the reader, the future of reading, is just one step at a time, out of the heart and the cerebral cortex. This time, this hinge moment, let us all choose with all our intelligence.